Coming. Welcome to Hudson Institute. I see some new faces, so those of you who haven't visited before, we are a non-partisan think tank promoting American leadership and global engagement for a secure, free, and prosperous future. I'm Nate Sibley. I do research and communications at the Kleptocracy Initiative, which founded in 2014. We perform research on how globalized corruption threatens democracy, capitalism, and security, with a particular emphasis on Russia and China. I've left some of our reports out around the table you may find interesting. I'm actually standing in for our director, Charles Davidson, today, who may be known to some of you. He's had to leave town because of a family bereavement. He sends his apologies. So it falls to me to welcome Gerald Knaus, who is the chairman and co-founder of the European Stability Initiative, which he's led since 1999. He studied in Oxford, Brussels, and Bologna before teaching economics in Ukraine, worked with governmental and NGOs in Bulgaria and Bosnia-Herzegovina. From 2001 to 2004, he was director of the Lessons Learned Unit of the EU pillar of the UN mission in Kosovo. He co-founded the European Council on Foreign Relations and has been a visiting and associate fellow at Harvard's Kennedy School. He is, if you follow European politics in any way, you'll know he's a highly respected, influential voice on many areas of European policy, particularly prominent in the area of human rights and migration, I think it'd be fair to say. He has co-authored several books, 12 TV documentary scripts, and more than 80 reports for ESI. Of particular interest today, I think, would be the Caviar diplomacy investigations, which were published in 2012 and updated at the end of last year. They show how Azerbaijan infiltrated the Council of Europe and subverted it through bribery. And really, like a blue, for the first time, perhaps the best example of how kleptocracies export corruption. So on that note, I'm going to be quiet and hand you over to Gerald.
Thanks a lot. Well, first of all, thanks a lot to the Institute for hosting this and for your initiative, and thank you for your interest. I'll get up because then I can see the slides and I can give signs when to switch them. What I will do is present you a little story that I think has global ramifications and implications. A story from Europe about a rather obscure, to many, international institution, and what might seem at first sight a rather ordinary case of human greed, that in fact I think testifies to something much bigger and something much more worrying about the state of liberal democracy in Europe. So let me begin with the first slide. Well, when we talk about foes of human rights in Europe, we all know who to think of. The obvious candidates, autocracies in the East, places where journalists are arrested, opposition parties banned, demonstrators led to jail, Putin, Aliyev, Nazarbayev, and a group of other countries in the eastern half of the continent. But what if the weak link in defending human rights in Europe is not quite as obvious? What if the challenge of defending human rights in Europe is not so much an external challenge, but internal to what we called or still call the West? Now, in recent years, we've seen the rise of governments in Europe that sit around the table of the heads of government of the European Union that proudly embrace the adjective of being illiberal. And these two friends, Viktor Orban and Mr. Kaczynski from Poland, in this cover of a Polish paper, They Defend Europe, have actually been arguing that what we need in Europe is a very different idea, understanding of democracy. Of course, you all know Marine Le Pen, who is almost certain, which is in itself remarkable, to reach the runoff in the French elections in April and May this year, and who has vowed to completely dismantle the Europe that we know, including the European Union, but also human rights commitments. Well, and your president is an inspiration to a lot of these people around Europe. Illiberals on the rise everywhere. We will have an election in a few weeks in the Netherlands, where Geert Wilders is currently still narrowly leading in the polls. Geert Wilders, who has built his whole campaign recently on essentially religious intolerance and very fierce rhetoric against minorities, but also against the European Union. We have the Alternative für Deutschland in Germany. And of course, we have already another president, this time from the allegedly center-left, Mr. Seemann, in the Czech Republic. The phenomenon of illiberalism isn't constrained to any one political group. But what all or most of these illiberals have in common is a great love for Russia, a very newly discovered enthusiasm for the United States. They used to be very anti-American. A great resistance to the European Union and no interest in institutions protecting human rights. So why in this context does the institution I want to talk about a little bit matter, the Council of Europe? Now, let me take you back to a situation which in some ways is reminiscent of today. When the Council of Europe was created in 1949, one of the inspirations, British former Prime Minister and then later Prime Minister again, Winston Churchill, then in opposition, said that for Europe to hold together, there needs to be a core, a spiritual core. There needs to be something beyond naked interest. And his idea was that a union of European states founded on the idea of liberty and democracy would form this core. Pierre-Henri Taitgen, a fighter in the French resistance, arrested by the Gestapo, he managed to escape. He became General de Gaulle's first Minister of Justice, one of the architects of post-war European institutions. And one of the people who in 1949, in the first meeting of the Council of Europe created after Churchill's inspiring speeches, warned of the need to be alert not only against the dangers Europeans knew well, fascism, which of course still existed in Spain and Portugal at the time, but also of course Soviet subversion. Don't forget, at that time in the late 40s, Stalinist parties were first or second in elections in Italy and France. So Taitgen said, what we need as democracies is tripwire, something that warns us. Democracies don't disappear all at once. We've seen that in the 30s. So the idea to create a binding institution with a binding commitment to human rights, to measure established democracies and to warn of dangers, that was the idea that came out at the time. It's the kind of idea I think Europe needs more than ever today. In 1950, European leaders met in Rome in the Barberini Palace underneath this wonderful fresco commissioned by Pope Urban VIII. What's interesting about the fresco, two things. Well, of course, you see here this little detail that became the flag of the Council of Europe and later the European Union, the crown of immortality. There was lots of speculation later whether this was a secret Catholic symbol when, for example, Sweden decided to join the EU. But the other interesting thing is, of course, the link to corruption. I mean, this pope was one of the most corrupt popes ever. And the Barberini family had all the money for this palace because it was rather corrupt. So a warning there right from the beginning about what might undermine the great ideas agreed to when the European Convention on Human Rights was signed. The idea, and what was important about this, was this European Convention was the first binding document. It was not like the UN Declaration of Human Rights, which the Soviet Union could accept, and Saudi Arabia abstained. It was not just a declaration of intentions. It was created with the idea that there would be a court to enforce it. So this was a revolutionary concept. So now we have this court, we have it in Strasbourg. The members of this court, the judges, who can make binding judgments that apply to the member states, are elected by the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, proposed by member states. We have the Council with a General Secretary, this man, who a former Prime Minister of Norway, also for many years the head of the Nobel Peace Prize Committee. He is the General Secretary of the Council of Europe. He was the one who gave the Nobel Peace Prize to the EU and to President Obama. Next one. And we have the Assembly, which is a body composed of elected members of national parliaments. These are members of the German Bundestag, of the French Parliament, of the Irish Parliament, of the Russian Duma, that are coming together four times a year. It's actually quite an intense institution, four times a year for a week, and then in between their committee meetings. More than 300 members of parliament that meet in Strasbourg. Now, after this binding convention was agreed, the Brits had pushed for it. They were really surprised when one of the first cases where it was used was against them, because they had just assumed this was for the less stable democracies elsewhere in Europe. But of course, in British colonial Cyprus, there was an uprising in 1954, which Britain repressed rather brutally. If you count the number of people that were then put in detention to the relationship of the population of Cyprus, it would be as if Turkey today would put in detention 500,000 people. The death penalty was used, even for possession of arms. But Greece then took Britain to the European Court of Human Rights, and Britain was terribly embarrassed. It said in the Foreign Office, the debate was, can we leave the Council? Well, we can't really, because we've created it. So what do we do? Well, let's see if we perhaps can make some concessions. So actually, in its first big test, the Council actually had some impact. We will see in a second why it didn't have the same impact on France and Algeria. Well, and then, of course, Greece under the military dictatorship, the junta, 1967, when the Council moved to expel it and Greece then left. So as a non-democracy, it couldn't be a member. That was the idea. You have to be a member, you have to be a democracy, you have to respect basic human rights. In 1990, the greatest hour for the Council of Europe, Václav Havel, left prison, goes to Strasbourg, gives a speech as president of then Czechoslovakia and says that this is the most important institution. He picked up Churchill's tradition of the spiritual union, the values. This is what we are all aspiring to. This is our lodestar. And the Council of Europe expanded in areas, in fields such as anti-corruption, GRECO, one of the most important bodies supposedly to give advice on how to fight corruption around the world. The United States is also affiliated. And of course, the expansion to enlargement with 47 members. Massive expansion, more than doubling the population and number of member states. With Russia joining in the 90s and with the Caucasus Republics joining in 2001, Armenia and Azerbaijan. So let me go into the story of what happened then, very shortly. Azerbaijan joins the club in 2001. The son of the Azerbaijani president immediately starts acquiring his international experience in the parliamentary assembly. Ilham Aliyev, son of President Haydar Aliyev, becomes vice president of the parliamentary assembly of the Council of Europe. In 2003, he becomes president, and from that moment on, starts what we described in a report in 2012, a concerted attempt by the Azerbaijani government to subvert the critical monitoring role of the Parliamentary Assembly and of the Council of Europe. We described it in a report we called Caviar Diplomacy. This was one of the quotes. This is what Azerbaijani officials told us. But of course, we couldn't give their names, and we couldn't name exactly who was bribed for the simple reason that it's too dangerous for them to be exposed, for them and their family. But when we published this, the deputies are regularly invited, generously paid, 30 to 40 of these 300 every year. There were conferences, events, summer vacations, gifts were left in the rooms. There was gold, there was silver, there were expensive carpets worth thousands of euros. There was drinks, there was caviar regularly given to everybody in Strasbourg, and there was money. Caviar was like the symbol. Caviar diplomacy is how the Azerbaijanis called it themselves internally. When we called the report this like this, it became a big media event. Lots of people wrote about it. But in Baku, I later learned, the officials who were most described reacted with amusement. One of them said to another, who I talked to last year, that when they read this, they said, they appreciate our genius. There was no sense that this being revealed would make any difference. And they were right. So we wrote this report, we expected a reaction, there was no reaction, except articles in the media. This man, Elkan Süleymanov, was the point man for Caviar Diplomacy, a former Soviet cinema director and member of the Parliamentary Assembly in Strasbourg. Now in January 2013, we saw just how little our report had changed. There was a vote on political prisoners. A German member had reported on political prisoners in Azerbaijan. There had been such reports before, and they had usually been followed by criticism and people being released. This time, there was a record turnout. Never have more MPs from across Europe come to Strasbourg to vote. And they felt so strongly about this, because they wanted to defend Azerbaijan against the charge that there might be political prisoners, or that it should do more to avoid arresting people who were innocent. 125 to 79, this was a record turnout. If you listen to the speeches in 2013, January, and I listened to it live, that members of parliaments from Spain, from Britain, from Ireland, from Poland, made to argue why they defended Azerbaijan and voted down a detailed and very well-written report by the rapporteur to say there were no political prisoners. If you listen to these speeches, you'll think you are in a post-truth world already in 2013. but people didn't really pay attention. Who defeated the resolution? Well, there's also a geographical element to this. All the Russians, it's the largest delegation, all the Turks, all the Spaniards, most Italians, majorities in the UK and France. In the UK, it was a party split. It was the Tories who were all with Azerbaijan and Russia at that time in a party group. Who defeated? Well, who was defeated? All the Germans, all the Swedes, all the Balts, and most of the Scandinavians. Now, this had consequences. There was a wave of arrest, and some of the most, the Václav Havels of this generation of Europeans, some of the most courageous dissidents were arrested. For example, Anna Mamatli. Now, the irony is he'd actually worked on the Council of Europe report on political prisoners. So this was really putting the finger into the eye of the Council of Europe by the Azerbaijanis. They arrested him later that year. They arrested immediately after the vote Ilgar Mammadov, who had run the Council of Europe School of Politics in Baku, and who was also an opposition politician. So the sign was, now that the Council of Europe had said, we are fine, we will arrest everybody who'd worked with the Council of Europe. Ilgar Mammadov is still in prison since early 2013, although the Court of Human Rights has said many times that he should be released because it was a political imprisonment. Anna Mamadli had also been the leading election observer in Azerbaijan. This is another extraordinary story. We wrote a report on this in 2013. We couldn't believe that an instrument as sophisticated as international election observation, which Europeans had done for more than 20 years, all the time, where there were manuals, where there were scholars, where there were books written, how huge theoretical and practical experience acquired, how to measure whether elections were free and fair, that in 2013, for example, there was an election in Azerbaijan, and of the 50 election observation missions who came to the country, 49 said these elections were superb, free and fair. These were all short-term observers. They included people whose trip had been paid by mysterious NGOs around Europe, but they included also the delegation from the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe. The only institution of the 50 who said these elections were some of the worst they'd ever observed were the long-term observers of the OSCE. They actually had been there for a long time. They had a manual. They couldn't be bribed. They had a methodology, and I know from people that I talked to in that mission, there were attempts to bribe them, but it didn't really work because they didn't actually make up their opinion after 2 days of walking around the country. In fact, there's a pattern. The whole experience, all the acquired expertise of election monitoring can be led into an absurd situation with absurd judgments if you just take a little bit of money into the hands. And that, to us, was a shock, how easy this was in 2010, 13, and 15. And again, when we wrote about this, when we described this, and you have the report online, we thought there might be a reaction. There was no debate in the Parliamentary Assembly. Nobody was interested. Anna Mamadli wins the Václav Havel Prize in 2014. It's the leading human rights prize of the institution. It's given by an independent committee of respectable people. He wins the prize while he is in jail. And Azerbaijan is the chairman of the institution. I mean, you can't invent this. This is Samuel Beckett. And of course, this is a nice, I took a screenshot of this website. The Commission of Human Rights says, stop reprisals. Everybody I know, he says, the Commissioner for Human Rights of the institution, everyone I know is in jail, while on the right you see, under the Secretary General, the chairmanship of Azerbaijan and all the activities they are doing to promote the activities of the institution. There was no shame. There was no sense that there was anything in need of explanation. So we were pretty disappointed, but we kept working on the issue, and what I tell you now is the story of the last half year. It turned out that there was much more to the vote in 2013 than was known at the time. This man was then the leader of the biggest political group in the Parliamentary Assembly, the European People's Party. That's the group of Angela Merkel and Sarkozy and Italian Christian Democrats. He was the leader of that group in the Parliamentary Assembly, and he strongly lobbied to defeat the resolution on political prisoners. Luca Volonte, a very conservative Italian from Milan. Now, Luca Volonte visited Azerbaijan for the first time in spring 2011, and he was invited by Elkan Süleymanov, the man behind Caviar diplomacy. And now I'm quoting letters that we know about because the police investigation started a few years ago, and these letters were found in Luca Volonte's office. An email: Dear Elkan, thank you for everything. Thanks to you, I've discovered a very interesting country. Our friendship is certainly growing. Your gifts are very tasty and very precious. 3 exclamation marks. When our report came out in 2012, the secretary of the EPP in Strasbourg, of this group, wrote to Volonté, another email that we saw, where she said, it's really amazing, the Azerbaijanis are really getting out of control. And Volonté wrote back and said, don't worry about this, this must be an Armenian conspiracy. He had actually been in Baku a month before, next one, to arrange for this. At the end of the year, a few weeks before the vote on political prisoners, money started arriving in his bank accounts. He had a foundation and he had a private company, which he just set up for this purpose just before. And the money arrived, 320,000 euros in December. And then it kept arriving, totaling to almost 2.4 million euros. And then it stopped. It only stopped because the police in Italy started inquiring what this money was for. Next one. Volonté in December also in these emails took a very active role in mobilizing all the friends of Azerbaijan in all the different delegations. I don't bore you with the names, but just to show, this includes British conservatives, Polish ex-communists, Italian, Spanish liberals, British liberals like Michael Hancock, Italian far-right politicians, and Pedro, his special friend, who later became the head of the EPP group and is today the president of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, the representative of this august institution. After the political prisoner vote, Volonté wrote to Süleymanov, hi, did you forget about me after your victory? He really was pushy. And Süleymanov wrote back, my dear friend, I'm in Warsaw now. I will let you know as soon as I get the answer from my friend. I'm sure that I will still surprise you with the respect I have for you. You are my devoted friend forever. What does that mean? Well, Volonté's email to the Azerbaijanis in January also said, your wish is my command. So I think we should discuss the new version of the strategy to do whatever they wanted to do during the next meeting in Baku with Elkan and Pushkov. Who's Pushkov? Alexei Pushkov is one of the key people in the Kremlin. He's actually the chair of the Foreign Affairs Committee there. He's also the leader of the Russian delegation to the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe. So it wasn't just Azerbaijan. I mean, this strategy wasn't just thought up in Baku. How the money reached Volonté, now this is why we know so many details, because some Italian authorities did their job. They were suspicious. Why does money arrive from a company called Metastar Invest, registered in Birmingham via a bank in Estonia, to a bank in Italy, with no originator and no real purpose, except written with an Azerbaijani misspelling, Fear Consulting Services? Or why does it come from the Marshall Islands, which is a little island somewhere in the Pacific? Money from the Marshall Islands arriving in the Baltic states and then arriving in Italy. So they asked Volonté, the bank first asked, and then the authorities asked him, he couldn't say, and then the investigation of the prosecutors in Milan started. These were only some of the companies from which the money arrived. Next one. In December, The Guardian published an interesting article, December last year, where it said that one of these companies, Metastar, actually was run by two other companies, which have since been dissolved, which were based in Belize, and there appears to be a link to money stolen in Russia from the Hermitage Capital Management Fund. If you've heard about the Magnitsky case, that's apparently that. So I have no idea if that's true. The Guardian wrote it. I suppose they did their research. But it suggests that this is very interesting, these companies. I mean, it appears it wasn't just money for Luca Volonté that transited. Volonté was interviewed on Italian television. They did a documentary, which is wonderful to watch. It's in Italian, but there is an English transcript. It's online, Rai Tre, the public, major investigative format on public TV, where he had the following dialogue. He said, well, this was a consultancy I did. The foundation drew up an agreement, Mike Foundation, his foundation, a convention. Rai asked, so which lasts for 10 years? Yes, it lasts for 10 years. For how much? $1 million a year. 10 million then, yes. That money was paid for advice which I personally provided to Süleymanov as president of his NGO. So in fact, he wasn't supposed to get 2.4 million, he was supposed to get 10 million. What I've heard recently, talking to an Azerbaijani diplomat, was that the budget, again, no way of verifying this, but the budget for a year for this kind of activity in Strasbourg was between 30 and 40 million. That's what an Azerbaijani former diplomat tells me. Don't know if it's true, but it doesn't seem implausible. How to take back an institution like this? Well, the first thing is we need a broad coalition and we need transparency and sunlight. People need to see what's going on. So the first thing we did was we published another report. We called it the European Swamp. Unfortunately, that's not a good term nowadays. So we then make it popular under the name Caviar Diplomacy Part 2. And there we describe in great detail so that anybody can understand it and translate it into German and into other languages that MPs around Europe can read, the story of what has happened. We also try to build a coalition. We can't shame Azerbaijan, but we should be able to shame British, Spanish, French, or Italian members of the Parliamentary Assembly. Amnesty, from their headquarters in London, got in and wrote a very strong letter saying there needs to be a thorough and independent investigation of this. Transparency International, which had worked with GRECO for many years, came out very strongly saying this was a real problem. And for an institution like the Council of Europe that is teaching others how to fight corruption, this really had to be addressed. We then wrote a report in January, a few weeks ago, where we called the Council of Europe the FIFA of human rights. And I'm still hoping for somebody who knows somebody in the team of John Oliver. I went to New York, I talked to a few people, perhaps something will come out of it. Because he did this wonderful segment on FIFA where he said, bribery and FIFA go together like peanut butter and jelly. And in fact, of course, then in the end something happened. FIFA had an investigation and somebody, the president of the organization, resigned. Well, in April 2015, ironically, PACE, the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, had a resolution on the reform of football governance, where it was really tough with FIFA. It said FIFA had a duty to be exemplary in their external action and in their systems of internal governance. And we wrote about this and said, this is exactly right. The problem is football is slightly less important than political prisoners and democracy. And you are slightly more important than FIFA. And compared to FIFA, your systems of internal accountability are scandalous. FIFA is really great compared to you. It at least has an ethics commission. In the Council of Europe Code of Conduct, which I realized talking to a lot of members in the last few weeks as we ran around Strasbourg or as we met people in parliaments and showed them the Code of Conduct, which says, of course, you cannot accept gifts over the value of 200 euros without declaring it. You have to, I mean, all what is in Codes of Conduct. But the only sanction in case of serious and repetitive breaches are these two. Temporary deprivation of the right to speak and temporary deprivation of the right to sign an amendment or a declaration. And there is only one person who can impose this sanction. Next one. This man, Pedro Agramunt, one of the leaders of the Caviar Coalition and today the president of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe. He's been rapporteur in Azerbaijan for many, many years. He went to every single election in Azerbaijan in the last 10 years. Here he is with Luca Volonte. He also was the head of the EPP group, and today he's the president of the parliament. He is the only one who can impose, in case of serious and repeated breaches, the devastating sanction of not being allowed to speak in that assembly. There is no provision, actually, for an internal independent investigation. But we just decided not to care, and together with Amnesty and Transparency, we reached out to as many members of the assembly as possible, and then they began to put pressure on Agramunt. Agramunt's reaction, informally, I was told, was to say, who are these NGOs? Are they paid by the Armenians? Fortunately, we're not paid by Armenians. So I'm looking forward to him challenging our reputation. In fact, he probably won't, because by now so many of the members of his assembly have come out calling for an independent investigation. Next one. The winter session took place in January this year for 1 week. The Europe head of Amnesty was there. I went there and we tried to talk to as many people as possible. Next one. And there were some MPs. And this is the key. Nothing happens unless you have people in the institutions who decide to actually fight for it. So there was a German Social Democrat, there was a Dutch Christian Democrat from the two big political families, there were Swedish liberals, there were people from the Green Party, there were a broad alliance of people, all the Nordics, all the Scandinavian countries in the Baltics and Iceland together, signed a strong letter to Agramund and said, we insist as whole delegations that there is a serious independent external investigation of this. The Swiss delegation, all of them signed it. The Dutch delegation, Luxembourg. I mean, basically, those countries that were defeated in the past but had never organized, they'd never come together. Now they came together, and these two, a German and a Dutch, wrote a declaration which was signed by already more than 70 people, and forcing this onto the agenda. And at the end of that week, Agramund said, okay, okay, we'll have an independent investigation. Now, it remains to be seen what will happen. In March, they will meet in Madrid. They will discuss it, and in April is the next session. Now, the bigger picture of all of this, however, why should you care about this as Americans far away? And perhaps with some friends in Azerbaijan, then you should care, because they suffered. The bigger picture is, why does this matter to Baku or Moscow and other illiberal capitals in Europe? It matters because they realize strategically that if you want to shame a government, you need a sense of concepts, languages. You need all those resolutions to mean something. When the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe declares that Azerbaijani autocracy is really democracy, that stolen elections, like the last four, are really free and fair, which they've said every time, that the dissidents are really what the Azerbaijanis say they are, hooligans or criminals. When this is certified and given a stamp of approval by an institution like the Council of Europe, what's the use of Amnesty and Human Rights Watch and others writing detailed reports? Who are they addressing with those reports, when the institutions that are a core audience are actually outside of the room eating caviar and drinking champagne with some of those autocracies? So the reason Baku and Moscow invest a little bit of money in this, and it's really not that expensive if you think about it, is because nobody will be fooled to believe Azerbaijani elections are free and fair. What they really want to achieve is a sense that we don't even know what free and fair elections look like. The concept makes no sense. It really is Orwellian. It's newspeak. It's black-white, one of the nicest concepts in newspeak. Now, I thought at the time, already a few years ago, that this didn't bode well for our democracies. I mean, if we didn't even react strongly to this, who knows what will come next? But I had no idea how quickly newspeak and black-white would arrive at the center of our Western countries. Binding commitments, like the European Convention on Human Rights, are really crucial for human rights. Now, the US knows this. This is why you created a Supreme Court. Somewhere outside a non-political body that, in Europe, of course, we have national Supreme Courts, but we also have the European Court of Human Rights. Because as Richard Rorty, the British moral philosopher, pointed out, the problem of immoral politics, or is he American? I don't know. The problem of immoral politics isn't the psychopath. It's the ordinary men and women doing bad things under pressure or being misled. I give you an example. Luca Volonte, curiously, I came across this doing the research, proposed a few years ago that this man, Robert Schumann, should be canonized by the Catholic Church. That doesn't happen very often to politicians nowadays, but Volonte has good contacts in the Vatican. And he said that Robert Schumann, who, of course, famously proposed the coal and steel community, was instrumental in German-French reconciliation, was one of the architects behind the Council of Europe. I mean, he was one of the great, great statesmen. And the day he proposed the coal and steel community in 1950 is still today, the Schumann Declaration Day, the holiday of the European Union. The main square in Brussels is called Schumann Square. So Volonte proposed, let's make him a saint. And I don't know how far these debates are going in the Vatican. But here is the interesting story about Schumann. He actually illustrates the importance of binding human rights commitments. Because in 1955, Robert Schumann, the great hero of human rights and defender of European integration, was also Minister of Justice in France. The Algerian War had just started with a wave of terrorist attacks by Algerian rebels. And France decided to react with brutal repression. In 1955, the security forces were given de facto impunity by decree that Schumann, as Minister of Justice, agreed to. State of emergency was imposed. This was followed by the authorization of detention camps for huge numbers of people. The Minister of Interior at that time is also well known. François Mitterrand. He later became president of France. And as we know now, it's not a secret. Next one. This general, Paul Ossarès, was then responsible for repressing the uprising. He wrote a book in 2001 after praising the return of torture as a tool of Western policy. He'd actually gone after the Algerian War as to teach torture in various military academies in South America. He also taught for a while in the US. He wrote a book in 2001 explaining how the French defeated the rebellion in Algeria. Well, in the end, of course, they failed. But house arrests, people disappeared, summary executions. I mean, he literally proudly names the people that they killed after arresting them or that they tortured. Only rarely were the prisoners we questioned during the night still alive the next morning. Now, the question here for me is, this is France after it has already joined the Council of Europe. So how is this possible? And the answer actually is very interesting. France did not ratify the European Convention until the early 1970s, until after it lost Algeria. It somehow had this vision that the British didn't have, that the colonies and human rights commitments might be an awkward combination. So France, actually, a founding member of the Council of Europe, and all the great speeches by the former French Minister of Justice, we need this as a tripwire, as a warning, didn't actually ratify the convention. He could speak so openly about this because this was followed by a complete amnesty. So he was actually brought to court, not because of all the murders he proudly admitted to, but because it was considered that he was praising torture, which today was not a good idea. He has since died. So here is the image. It's Ulysses tying himself to the mast. This is what these institutions are for. Because even democracies will be led astray. It's not the bad people. It's the people like Schumann who, under pressure, when there is an emergency, when there is fear of terrorism, when there's a state of emergency, might resort, even in countries like France or Britain or anywhere, really, to measures that violate human rights. And that's why we need these institutions. And that's why we need them in Europe now, today, more than ever before. But they need to be credible. And they're only credible if the European Convention of Human Rights or the court serve the role of the canary in the coal mine when there is a signal that something's going wrong. When they don't serve this function, when we have Azerbaijan as a member and being praised for its democracy and its progress, then by what standard do we judge others, from Turkey to Poland to Hungary, to France, to Germany, any other country, any other democracy, which, as we know, will always be imperfect? I end with the picture of another a friend and another great Azerbaijani dissident who's written a lot about corruption, who's been jailed, who's been in jail, who still can't leave the country, Khadija Ismailova, and who still hasn't given up on human rights. And she says, when it comes to those issues, what to name Azerbaijan and how to talk about it, life is very complicated, but sometimes we get lucky and offer the clear choice between truth and lies. That's the quote which we've been sending to all the MPs of the assembly, and we will see how they will react. And if you want to know more, all our reports and analysis is there. And by now, I fear this story is unfortunately more relevant to our democracies than even we thought possible 3 years ago. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I think I found that absolutely fascinating. I'm sure you all did as well. We're going to have a bit of a discussion Q&A session now. This bit that was on record, this bit's off record, so hopefully you can ask whatever you want. And hopefully, Gerald feel comfortable, giving a bit fuller answer than you would before. I was just going to start with a quick question. Thinking back to the